Recorded Books presents To Catch a Storm by Mindy Mejia. Narrated by Alex Pineda, Brian Hutchison, and Libby McKnight. Thursday. A quote from Alan Lightman. We try to connect. We try to find truth. We dream and we hope. And underneath all of these strivings, we are haunted by the suspicion that what we see and understand of the world is only a tiny piece of the whole. Eve. 20,000 feet in the air, I flew between the storm and the sun. Beneath the plane, a steely blanket of nimbostratus clouds covered the earth. I'd been making passes through this system for hours, while two PhD students hunched over equipment stations, single-mindedly collecting data to complete their research. The way this massive rainstorm was progressing, we might be the only people in Iowa to see the sun today. I watched the fiery orange sunrise crest the horizon and enjoyed it on behalf of everyone in the state. I should have been worried about the implications of this supercell. A cold front was moving in from the north, which spelled imminent disaster for life on the ground. But it hadn't touched me yet. At this altitude, whether I was skipping over cirrus wisps or circling the mouth of a cyclone, there was nothing but calm. Here, I was above the weather. Dr. Roth? One of my students approached the cockpit. There's a strange readout from the airport station. Can you take a look? Sure. I've already obtained landing clearance. Why don't you start taking us down? He slid into the co-pilot chair, clearly thrilled by the chance to log more airtime, and I lingered for an extra minute, making sure he readied our descent correctly. The plane was my baby, a $3.2 million mobile air lab. Every instrument and panel lining the wings and cabin was custom designed to study atmospheric physics, sonic anemometers, cloud particle imagers, and electromagnetic lightning sensors. There was no storm this plane couldn't dissect. When Matthew asked me what I was going to call her, claiming it was unlucky to fly a plane with no name, I didn't hesitate. Joan. His face had clouded for an instant before getting the joke. Jet? I'd patted the sleek underbelly of the aircraft. She's not afraid of a little noise. In the years since Joan's christening, I'd flown her everywhere from Tornado Alley to the Rockies, soaring over the continent long after drones assumed most of the weather reconnaissance in the field. They could call me old school, I didn't care. I wouldn't give up this view for anything. I checked the readouts from one of the ground monitoring stations at the Iowa City Municipal Airport. CO2, a thermal pocket approximately 800 meters south. It appears to be standard combustion. A fire? Paulwin, my other student, moved to verify the reading. In this cell? It didn't seem probable that any kind of fire could survive this storm, but instruments didn't lie. Had something happened at one of the hangars or the terminal building? We checked other nearby stations, and Paulwin pointed out a corroborating pattern in his own data, when a sudden jolt of turbulence almost knocked me out of my seat. We'd descended into the system now. Rain pelted the windows and our visibility dropped to zero, making it instrument-only navigation from here on out. Keep it steady, I called to the cockpit, making my way back to the controls, but another violent shift in airflow caught Paulwin off guard, and he slammed into me, sending both of us into a cabinet and tumbling to the narrow strip of floor. Dr. Roth? Panic lanced the pilot's voice. The instrument panel shook, rattling hurricane-proof glass above our heads. Paulwin scrambled up, apologizing as he staggered to avoid collapsing on me a second time. I thumped him toward one of the seats outfitted with a 5-point safety harness and ran through the jerking plane to the cockpit. Strapping in, I took back the controls as we broke through the bottom of the cloud layer, the rolling subdivisions and snaking line of the Iowa River, less than 2,000 feet below. The student mumbled apologies into his headset as I lined up our approach. His research on ice crystal formation was excellent, but he was no storm chaser. He wouldn't have made it 10 minutes during the expedition to Argentina last summer, where barbed hail shaped like medieval torture devices nearly chewed up the plane with us inside it. I radioed the airport and received the air traffic controller's familiar confirmation. She sounded normal. Gail had worked at the airport for decades and not much rattled her, as long as she had a steady supply of coffee and Marlboros. But maybe she didn't know. Maybe the weather station had picked up something the building's smoke alarms hadn't. Everything okay down there, Gail? Living the dream, Dr. Roth. Living the American dream. Arrival area is clear for landing. As I deployed the landing gear, the student next to me inhaled sharply and pointed south. There. A plume of pure black eclipsed the hazy gray morning, narrow at its base and expanding and dispersing as it rose. It wasn't coming from the airport. It billowed behind the woods beyond the runway. A ground disturbance, I said as the plane touched down, wheels skidding on the rain-slicked runway. You can exclude it from your data set. But the anomaly lingered in my mind as I taxied toward the hangar. Not the pressure-tossed multi-million-dollar airplane or the student who'd floundered thousands of feet above the ground. The black cloud. Everything about it felt wrong. Unnatural. It didn't belong in my sky. As the students downloaded data and performed post-flight maintenance, I unlocked one of the hangar cabinets and grabbed my phone. Cellular devices interfered with navigation, and I'd stopped allowing phones on board altogether after I caught several students texting mid-flight. 3 messages filled the screen, all from my father-in-law, Earl. You landed? Come home when you land. The police are here. 2 Iowa City police cruisers were parked in front of our remodeled Victorian when I pulled into the driveway. Normally, my eyes lifted every time I came home, finding the cupola above the master bedroom and the widow's walk cutting across the roof, where weather instruments lined up like crows along a telephone wire. Today, I didn't linger. I jabbed the garage door opener and sped past the house to the detached garage, not pausing until the door lifted and I registered the empty space inside. Earl's van was there, but Matthew's Tesla wasn't. It should have been parked next to his charging station, the Bob license plate greeting me like it always did. Ross? I'd guessed, totally confused when he'd bought the custom plates. Matthew had shaken his head, grinning. Dylan, he's not afraid to go electric. Matthew loved his Tesla almost as much as I loved my plane, and he insisted on driving anytime we went somewhere as a family. But where would he have gone now, leaving his father alone with the police? I parked and ran through the downpour toward the back door, where a uniformed officer met me on the porch. Where's Earl? Is he all right? He's inside, ma'am. He's fine. The officer gestured for me to go in first. Earl sat by the kitchen table, his matted hair and hunched shoulders drifting to one side of his wheelchair. A massive stroke had robbed most of his vocal ability, but his good hand lifted when he saw me. I dropped to a squat next to his chair, pressing his palm between mine. It felt cool, and his good eye looked clear as it focused on me. Are you okay? He nodded. The morning news he normally watched was on in the adjacent family room, and a second police officer stood behind the couch, conferring with his partner in a low voice. Where's Matthew? The coffee maker on the kitchen counter was off. After 7 years of marriage, I knew my husband's habits. He rose with the predictability and energy of the sun, bursting with outsized plans for what could be packed into the waking hours ahead of us. A 10-mile charity bike ride, a gourmet picnic on the banks of the Iowa River, a new video series for his YouTube channel, all while brewing his first caffeine of the morning. Even after the scandal this fall, after I'd told Matthew to move his things to the other end of the hall, I still woke almost every morning to the comforting whir of the coffee grinder. Today, like his garage space, the pot was empty. "That's why we're here, ma'am." One of the officers moved closer. "We're looking for your husband." Earl nodded at the table where a post-it note lay next to his iPad, scrawled with Matthew's handwriting. "Checking data on the grant before submission deadline, back by 9. It was 9:21. I texted Matthew from the airport after I'd gotten Earl's messages, but he hadn't replied. "Do you know what time he left this morning?" the officer asked. I stood up, trying to process the note. "No, I had a flight scheduled for 6 and was at the hangar by a little after 5. I told them what I could as my mind raced, trying to understand why Matthew would have gone to the university this morning. He wasn't teaching this semester, and though he still oversaw one of his major grant projects, he always made sure to work around my schedule. Earl had lived with us for almost 2 years since his stroke, and we never left him alone. He could manage small transitions between his bed and the toilet with his walker, but someone had to be nearby to supervise and assist if needed. I'd told both Matthew and Earl at dinner last night about my flight plan, and that I planned to head straight to campus afterward. This was the last week of classes in the semester, and every hour was tightly scheduled. Squeezing the flight in this morning had been a challenge. Matthew knew I'd be gone all day. Why would he leave his father? The officers asked more questions, some mundane, some bizarre, as the morning news played in the background. They wanted to know the last time I'd seen Matthew, how long he'd driven his Tesla, and whether we'd had any break-ins recently. I gave choppy, distracted replies as I called and texted, "Matthew, where are you? The police are here. Why are you looking for him? What happened?" They didn't answer immediately, and a sick feeling began spreading in the pit of my stomach. Earl grunted, twisting in his chair. "What is it?" He jabbed a finger at the television. A fireball erupted on the screen, brilliant oranges and reds coughing thick black smoke into the sky. It was so bright I couldn't see what was burning at first, just the fire itself, which filled the entire living room wall. Matthew had bought this TV. It was enormous, high definition, the kind of screen that made it feel like you could smell the stench of combustion and feel the heat of the flames. The shot panned out, becoming less grainy until there it was, the black cloud, the anomaly we'd identified in the storm. The clip ended, and the news cut to a reporter standing in front of the shell of a burnt-out car. Earl grunted again, quieter this time. "Ma'am?" The officer lifted his hat toward the screen. I didn't understand until he added, "That's why we're here." A caption underneath the reporter's face read, "Electric vehicle burns in Iowa City rainstorm." And finally, the car itself came into focus, the charred outline forming a silhouette I instantly recognized. On the bumper, the letters were scorched, blackened, but still legible. The cloud descended, blurring my vision, filling my lungs. My entire body shook as I stared at the license plate on the screen. Bob. It was Matthew's car. Eve. After the officers left, I kept trying to reach Matthew. All my calls went straight to voicemail. I tried not to panic each time I heard his smooth, pre-recorded tenor saying he was sorry he'd missed me. Where was he? Why hadn't he called immediately after the accident with his car? Every passing minute presented more questions and less time to answer them. My office hour at the university had already begun. After leaving an abrupt message for a grad student who'd been working with Matthew on his grant project, I packed Earl into the van and raced to campus. "Leave me at the house," Earl texted from the back seat. "It's not safe for you to be alone. As soon as Matthew gets home, he can pick you up." I tried to sound positive, but the words lacked conviction, drowning in the drum of rain against the van. We didn't know when Matthew would come home. We had a daunting lack of data. The line outside my office door was double the size I expected. Marine biology, computer science, and anxious pre-med majors sat along the wall, phones in hand as if camping out for tickets to a concert none of them wanted to attend. The first students in line jumped to their feet when I appeared, but one glance at the wheelchair I was muscling through the hallway halted their backpacks in mid-shrug. 2 minutes, please, I called as we wheeled past, and I promise to bear enough potential energy to convert all your queries into comfort. A few of them looked sick. I understood how they felt. I wanted to run straight to the biology building and find my best friend, Natalia Flores. Natalia would invite Earl into her office with a smile and a wave of manicured fingernails, entertaining him with stories about nights in Santa Cruz de la Sierra. And as soon as classes were over, she'd show up at the house with a bottle of Cab Sauv, a sectioned map of Iowa City, and a detailed plan to find Matthew. But Natalia wasn't on campus, or even in the state. She was finishing a semester abroad in Costa Rica with a troop of biochemistry students, and I had no guide for what to do next. Should I start calling hospitals? Swallowing another wave of anxiety, I pushed Earl to the administrative office and the maze of hand-me-down desks belonging to the TAs. Because I was the only physics professor at the University of Iowa who wore lipstick and Stella McCartney-platformed sneakers, most of the teaching assistants fell into one of two categories. They either thought I was cool and went overboard in displays of knowledge and work ethic, or they snubbed me for my serious male colleagues who spent their careers submerged in thought experiments about the milliseconds after the Big Bang. My work in atmospheric physics, predicting the trajectory and severity of storms and the meteorological effects of climate change on our pedestrian little planet, was, to some, merely cute. Normally, I didn't care about TA opinions, but today I needed a fan. Pawan had gone straight to campus from the airfield, and I found him hunched over his desk, analyzing the data he'd collected from our flight. He'd studied under me for 3 years now, and had attended every backyard Hawkeye pre-party Matthew had thrown, dressed religiously in black and gold. The two had spent hours drinking beer and talking sports, or whatever men did to prepare themselves to watch football games. And when Matthew bought the Tesla, Pawan had examined every inch of the machine, laughed at its name, and even helped wire solar panels for the garage. He was also one of the only TAs brave enough to say anything to me after Matthew was suspended this fall. Everyone else on campus fell suspiciously quiet the minute I walked into a room, but Pawan had asked if there was anything he could do. I'd said no at the time. Professionally, there was nothing to do except wait. An administrative panel had been formed to investigate the allegations regarding Matthew's behavior and decide whether to let him continue teaching. Now, though, I needed help. I parked the wheelchair by his desk. "Pawan Mishra, meet Earl Moore." Pawan gave a hesitant wave. I explained, "He's Professor Moore's father. Would you mind keeping him company during my classes this morning?" Earl had his iPad and was addicted to Candy Crush, even though he closed the app and denied it whenever I caught him playing. I hoped games would be enough to distract him, at least for a few hours. "Yes, of course." Pawan's hands worked nervously as though rubbing non-existent lotion into his palms. Did Professor Moore, is he? We don't know where he is. It was the first time I said it out loud, and saying it somehow made it more real. Matthew was missing. The knowledge had been building during the entire walk across campus, where every quad and path teemed with memories. The arched stone doorway of the building housing Matthew's office, dark with rain. The riverbank where we'd exchanged wedding vows, empty. I needed data, not ghosts. I needed to know where Matthew was, and that need ballooned in my chest until I practically vibrated with it. Two desks down, several TAs gathered around a computer, watching footage of a flaming car. Like a moth, I moved toward it and stared at the licking tongues of fire. One of the students turned to me, bright with excitement. Wouldn't it make a great case study for the biophysics lab? How a car can burn in the middle of a rainstorm? Oh my God. Pawan covered his mouth as the camera panned the Tesla silhouette and the license plate came into focus. The other TAs fell silent, looking from my face to Pawan's, their excitement paling as they realized this was about more than an academic experiment. Earl wheeled himself to my other side. Was, Pawan swallowed, fumbling for a discreet word. Anyone in the car? No. The officers had assured us no one was inside, but they also said all the windows had been lowered, which meant the rain would have soaked the interior and made it even less likely for a fire to catch or grow. How did it? I murmured. Something about the footage seemed off. Play it again. We watched the video twice more in silence. The clip was brief, the tail end of a spectacle captured from a distance. But I understood what felt wrong. The fire jumped, flaring erratically in different areas as if finding pockets of gunpowder like lost change scattered in the seats. How does a car burn in the middle of a rainstorm? On purpose. I don't know how I got through my office hour or the classes that followed. One part of my brain regurgitated a high-level review of Physics 101, moving mechanically from Newton to Einstein's field equations, while the rest of my mind replayed the footage on a loop, trying desperately to figure out what had happened this morning. Combustion was the simple chemical reaction of a fuel and an oxidant. The oxidant was the easy part, air. But what fuel? It could have been an interior or exterior source, and had to burn hot enough to sustain the reaction amid the deluge of cold rain. I cycled through possibility after possibility, playing out each scenario, trying to make the hypothesis fit what I'd seen in the footage and knew of the conditions of the environment and vehicle. When my students raised their hands, I stared at them blankly, seeing a black plume of smoke rise instead of fingers, hearing pops and hisses in place of words. Matthew always said I became obsessed with questions. Whenever I got an unexpected result, either inside the lab or out, I poured through variables, possibilities, and statistical models, anything I could find that would explain the outlier. He shouldn't have minded. It was why I became interested in him in the first place. The first time I met Matthew Moore at a University of Iowa networking event for new professors, he'd been the outlier. He looked like a Ken doll in a sea of conservative button-downs with his blonde, wavy hair and broad jaw, the rising star of the chemistry department. I expected him to drone on about his credentials and publication credits, but he spent the whole evening asking about my research and methodology. He wanted to know what it felt like to look inside a tornado, how the world changed at the edge of the troposphere. I wasn't used to male colleagues showing more interest in my work than their own, and when I told him that, he grinned and pushed his hair back to reveal over-large ears. I was embarrassed by them as a kid, but my mother said big ears made for exceptional listeners. Or that's just how she tricked you into behaving. He laughed and let his hair fall back into place. If that's true, it didn't work. So you're not an exceptional listener? Not if you asked my father. He leaned in closer, his voice falling beneath the noise of the crowd to a low, warm tone only I could hear. And he's right. The truth is, I only listen to the exceptional. After the event and fueled by a 3-hour open bar, we snuck into a lab in the chemistry building. I sat in front of a Bunsen burner, flame warmed, charmed, and knowing it, as Matthew swirled the contents of a beaker. As he added chemicals, the color changed from clear to purple to deepest blue. He took it off the flame and breathed my name into it, Eve Roth, and the substance bloomed into an iridescent ball, filling the beaker and trapping the light of the fire. What is it? Essence of Eve. No, honestly. I tried to examine the bottles of chemicals, wanting answers, but he coyly moved them aside. A magician never tells. That was Matthew's style. Big gestures, few explanations. It should have frustrated me, but we attracted like opposite poles of a magnet. He loved making things appear and watching me put together the pieces. A surprise trip to Paris for our anniversary. A petri dish in the fridge with a question mark taped to it like a dare. When he bought the old Victorian and gutted it, he had me walk through the studs of each room and guess, based on plumbing and electrical, what each space would become. I could almost see him standing by the Tesla as it burned, waiting for me to figure out the puzzle. If I did, would it bring him home? The black plume kept rising in front of me, an anomaly in the storm. I didn't know whether it was a signal fire or a warning. Dozens of keyboards clacked furiously throughout the lecture hall. Rain beat against the windows. I struggled through the review questions, trying to keep my voice from breaking, and hoped my shiny platform sneakers, lipstick, and rote relativity quips were enough to keep the facade in place. Earl's face, slack and blotchy with anxiety, swam through the uneven diagrams I drew on the smartboard. I hoped he wasn't hungry, or listing too far to one side, or any of the other 100 things he couldn't manage on his own. As long as he didn't need the bathroom where he wasn't used to navigating the stalls, it would be okay. I kept telling myself that while a larger, quieter part of my brain clenched against a rising tide of fear. Nothing about this day was okay. My cell phone vibrated in my pocket, long, insistent buzzes. I dismissed the class a full 10 minutes early without any of my usual end-of-term encouragements and rushed out of the lecture hall as a voicemail notification popped up. It wasn't Matthew. The message was from the Iowa City Police, asking me to come to the station as soon as possible.
Jonah. The details were slipping away. Sitting in the lobby of the Iowa City Police Department, I jotted notes, height, weight, gender, skin and hair color, trying to boil down the fading traces of what I'd seen into the kinds of facts law enforcement would listen to. I'd gotten here in under 40 minutes, burying the speedometer on the back country roads between Davenport and Iowa City. The speed kept my head clear, helping me focus on exactly what I'd seen. But that was 2 hours ago now. I'd been waiting on this bench while people shuffled in and out of the station, clouding my head with the wet dog stink of their fears and irritations. I was losing focus, losing the details. I'd seen a man, average height and build. I wrote down measurements, trying to make the numbers mean something. Winter white, bread dough skin. Big ears sticking out from his head, brown hair or maybe dark blonde. It was either wet or greasy. The harder I focused on the image, the more it blurred. And when I tried to chase it down to make the details stay, the drainpipe came instead. the black hole of its mouth yawning open and daring me to crawl inside. God damn it. I turned up the ambient music on my noise-canceling headphones and hunched over, folding into myself. The guy next to me slid toward the end of the bench, away from me. I bit down on the urge to ask him to move farther and drove the heels of my hands into my eye sockets, rocking back and forth. Synthesizer notes rose and twined into each other, filling my head. I tried to relax into them. Donica Chase, Angela Garcia. I didn't care who heard me mumbling, Kip Freeman, George Marcus Morrow. People I'd found. They were talismans, burning against the force of the others, the ones who stayed lost, who lived in the rotting underbelly of the drainpipe. The found were always harder to remember. I had to dig them from forgotten corners, remind myself they were real. Donica, Angela, Kit, George. I repeated their names until the drainpipe faded, and something else came into focus. A detail I hadn't remembered until now. A ring. Sitting up, I flipped to a new page and wrote, getting the words out before they disappeared beyond my reach. I had to make them stay. Craggy fingers wrapped my arm, a zip of mustard and impatience. I jerked away from the touch and impressions clinging to it, muscling down the urge to bolt, my head retracted back into the Iowa City police station with its dirty linoleum and rain-pounded windows, this delusion of shared reality. The guy sitting next to me lifted his palm. Easy, buddy, and pointed to the other side of the waiting room. The shock of contact sputtered out, leaving the tang of French's mustard in the back of my mouth. The front desk clerk shot me some narrowed side eye while she talked to the cop behind the metal detector, Max. He filled the archway with his unironic Captain America stance and gleaming head. He'd given up the fight with a receding hairline years ago. Bald suited him, unlike the sling holding his left arm against his chest. I scanned him for other injuries, but he wasn't giving away any weaknesses. Not to me. Not anymore. Max took me back to one of the interview rooms, hiding me from the rest of the station, like I hadn't already been sitting in the lobby half the morning. He closed the door and faced the one-way glass. When I took off my headphones, he was already talking. First day back, and you know what the captain said to me? Welcome back? I buried my hands in the pockets of my trench coat, pulling it tight across my shoulders, a physical reminder of where I stopped and everything else started. Most people didn't need to remember their edges, to draw the boundaries of their self on an hourly basis. He handed me a case, he turned around, and told me Kendrick's out. Max, ICPD doesn't work with Jonah Kendrick anymore. I get it. I fucked up. I paced the far side of the room, keeping the table between us, not looking at the sling, like that would block the low hum of pain radiating off it and echoing inside me like a tuning fork. But Selena's still out there, and I saw someone else this morning. A man. I dug the notebook out of my pocket and flipped to the page of details. Male. White. Blonde? I closed my eyes, willing the image back. Max sighed, and there was a long silence. Trace emotions infringed on my concentration, frustration mostly, mixed with pain, anger, and a hint of warmth, the cocktail I'd made of our friendship. But Max knew me well enough to keep his feelings in check. Maybe for my benefit, maybe for his. When he finally spoke, his energy was even, in control, a monolith with a bad arm. In a dream. Sweat dripped down my spine from the effort of holding the image in focus. It was a unique combination of attention and relaxation. I hadn't been relaxed in 4 months. Yeah, I don't know how he's connected to Selena, but sometimes it's just a dream. I know, but this is real, and it's the first lead we've had since Belgrave. A whip of emotion at the name. There and gone, but Max's reaction was so sudden it fractured my focus. The image of the blonde man wavered. Have you been drinking? Off your meds? Are you still sleeping in bathtubs? I opened my eyes. Sweat-soaked, dirty blonde hair melted into the sheen of Max's shaved head. I rubbed the heels of my hands into my temples, waiting for the rest of the interview room to return as the words sunk in. It wasn't what he said. It was how he said it. Like any cop in any city getting some crackpot tip, not a man talking to a friend he'd known 20 years. Not like Max. At least I can sleep, I tried to joke. Nothing. Not even a hint of a smile. He went for the door and I cut him off, blocking the way out. What is this? I told you, ICPD doesn't work with Jonah Kendrick. I'm sorry, okay? You have no idea how sorry I am, but don't throw the shit at me. I tried calling you this morning. I blocked your number. I hadn't heard him right. I couldn't have. I didn't know I was moving backward until my boots hit the door. I hadn't seen Max in 6 weeks, not since his wife Shelley tossed me out of his hospital room. She was right to do it. She should have kicked me out of their lives years ago, but this wasn't about us. This was a lead, and Max never turned down a lead. I need this job, Jonah. He spoke to the floor as the fluorescent lights glared off his head. I've got a family support, a mortgage, bills. Will you look at this? I ripped the paper out of my notebook with the description of the man in the ring. All I need is a name and I'll be gone. The interview room door opened, pushing me toward Max. I stumbled into his sling and a shock of pain ripped through him, echoing in me. He winced, but drew himself up when John Larson, ICPD captain of field operations, appeared in the doorway. Larson was more slab than man, with a ruddy face and a crew cut, the kind of cop who clocked every threat in the room before uttering a word. He looked past me like I didn't exist. Everything under control? Max jerked his head once. I'm showing him the door. Good. Larson didn't leave. His gaze narrowed on Max's sling and the sudden whiteness of his face. Larson was Max's direct superior, but I could feel his concern, his protectiveness. He was the type of person Max needed in his life. Someone who would watch his back. Someone who was the opposite of me. They talked about the forecast for a minute and how the department planned to handle the storm. Finally, Larson acknowledged my existence, and his energy cooled to the temperature of the coming freeze. Summerlin doesn't go hunting anymore. Understand? Max looked anywhere but at me. I've got a tip about Selena's case. We're still processing your last tip. Larson's energy turned hostile, boring into me. I hunched against the sheer force of it. I'll let you know when we're open for another one. Another investigator popped up behind Larson. Summerlin, the wife of your new case, is in the lobby. Max pulled me out of the room, past the growing blockade of blue. On it, thanks. Without my headphones, voices swarmed in on all sides. Looks, whispers, swirls of suspicion and sneering. As Max dragged me through the hallways, nausea began to build in my gut and my heart raced, pounding against the sudden constriction in my chest. I was off my meds today. I needed to be, to keep the image of the dream clear and recall as many details as I could. But I was naked without the medication, my head a fucking sieve chucked into the middle of the ocean, sinking, drowning. I couldn't keep the water out. Max, I tried to shake his grip, but he'd always been stronger than me. I can't do this. I stumbled into a desk, where two officers glared from either side of a wet-haired woman in handcuffs. She sniffed, and the misery and depression clotting that single noise made sweat break out on my forehead. I fumbled with my jacket, hands shaking, desperate for the headphones. No. Max got a better hold on my elbow. Keep the note. If I find it under my windshield wiper, I'll trash it. Max, we reached the lobby, and the shaking moved up my arms into my entire body, turning violent, taking over. Emotions swelled and mobbed together, shoving me under their waves. I fell against the desk, and the attendant jerked away from her keyboard with an electric jolt of fear. Max was still talking, but I couldn't make out the words. Everything bled together. White noise on black noise on galloping stabs of heartbeats that grew louder and louder. I was going under. Sweat poured down my face and I clenched down on the urge to vomit. I needed my headphones, but any movement now was a gamble. As I started sliding off the desk, a cushioned pressure enclosed my ears and the noise stopped. There was a beat of silence before slow-rising ambient chords surrounded me. I opened my eyes as Max stepped back, his good hand falling to his side. He looked as ball-shriveling ragged as I felt. I wanted to say something, to tell him I understood that I wouldn't shit all over his life anymore, that he deserved a better friend than I was capable of being, but before I could, he turned away. He was already done with me. Slowly, the lobby came back into focus. Everyone on the benches stared, and at least one person recorded the episode on their phone. Two people waited on the other side of the desk, a woman pushing the wheelchair of a silver-haired man who slumped to one side. A blast of fear rose off them, pure and undiluted, lowering the hood of her raincoat. The woman measured me with cautious, cat-like eyes. The old man's expression sagged like it had been fed halfway into a taffy pulling machine. Without warning, the dream returned. A man, white, blonde, sweat-soaked and trapped. The people at the desk weren't afraid of me. They were afraid for him, the man in the dream. I pushed myself up. Cold sweat dripped down my neck and spine. As a woman spoke to the front desk attendant, I slipped the note from my pocket into the hand of the man in the wheelchair.
Max. It was a hell of a first day back. On the way to my desk with the family of my newest case in tow, the eyes of the whole station followed me, furtive glances taking stock. They wouldn't meet my eyes, but they were watching. My arm hurt like a motherfucker. I'd thrown Jonah out on his ass in front of all of them. I made a parade out of it, and probably ripped some stitches in the process, and I already knew it wasn't enough. It might never be enough. I could serve on the ICPD for another 20 years, and to some of these officers, I'd still be Max Summerlin, the guy with a psychic best friend. Thanks for coming in so quickly. I picked up the garbage can by my desk and dropped it with a crash next to Suzeki's, a fellow investigator who spent most of his free time jawing in front of the vending machines. Did you hear? He fished for anyone who would listen. Did you hear how Summerlin really got shot? Turning away from the stairs, ignoring the shocks of pain stabbing through my arm, I focused on the interview at hand. The woman pushed the wheelchair into the spot where the garbage can had been and sat in the closest chair. She was in her late 30s, white, well-kept, with short, sleek hair the color of lit mahogany, and an expensive outfit that could have come straight out of a magazine. I put the man in the wheelchair around 80. He had a broad, sunken build and wore stained sweats and a Hawkeye hoodie. He'd been rooting around in his pocket for something since I met them in the waiting room, but came up empty-handed. "Have you found Matthew?" the woman asked. "His phone goes straight to voicemail, and the voicemail box is full." I hadn't even gotten to the station this morning when I landed this case. Larson texted me a link to the local news story as I was parking, and the assignment was waiting in my inbox as soon as I booted up my computer. I'd been back on active duty for all of 3 hours, but after dealing with Jonah, I was grateful for the distraction. A burned-up Tesla on the south side, no witnesses. It wasn't my first car fire. I'd seen plenty of stunts in this college town, most of them fueled by alcohol, drugs, and choices made in the no man's land between legal adulthood and fully developed brains. At first glance, the incident looked like theft with destruction of property, but the car's owner was nowhere to be found, and someone had managed to set fire to his Model S in the middle of a frigid December rain. That wasn't a stunt. That was determination. I had to consider the freeway, too. Iowa City sat right on I-80, the transcontinental belt connecting San Francisco to New York. One of the last cases I worked on before going out on disability was a fertilizer truck full of Miracle-Gro and opioids. $4 million worth of drugs packed neatly between bags of nitrogen. We might be a postcard skyline, blooming between hills of corn, a UNESCO city of literature. But trash blew in off the interstate every day. "We haven't located Mr. Moore yet, but there was a phone in the car that burned in the fire. Probably his, if you haven't been able to reach him." I sat down across from the missing man's wife and opened a fresh page in my notebook. The paper helped me focus, kept my mind on the case I was working and not on the one that sent me out on 6 weeks of disability with a gunshot wound. "When was the last time you saw him, Mrs. Moore?"
"Roth."
"Mrs. Roth, then. When did you last?" The old man grunted and picked up his iPad, jabbing out a message and flashing it at me with more authority than a slumping person in a wheelchair should possess. "Fine. Dr. Roth." She squeezed the old man's arm, giving him a ghost of a smile.
"Last night. I left this morning before either Matthew or Earl was awake."
"You're Matthew Moore's father? And you live at the same address?" The man started typing again, as the woman explained.
"Helen, Matthew's mother, passed away a few years ago, and Earl had a stroke shortly afterward. He's been putting up with us ever since. The elder Mr. Moore shoved his iPad across my desk. What are you doing to find my son?
We'll do everything we can to locate him.
Typically, we wouldn't be concerned about a competent adult's whereabouts when he's been gone less than a day. But we treat any citizen as a missing person when circumstances indicate their safety may be at risk.
Dr. Roth leaned over the briefcase in her lap.
Did anyone see the fire start? Do you think Matthew was there when it happened?
I'm waiting on the report from the fire department.
Let's stick with last night for a minute. Did you notice Matthew acting unusual? Did he seem off in any way? They both claimed he'd been quiet at dinner, but otherwise normal. He'd left a note for them this morning that he was going to work on some project at the university.
On campus?
She gave the name of his building. The Tesla hadn't been anywhere near campus, though. It had burned up in Ryerson's Woods Park, a patch of forest tucked between the fairgrounds and a highway on the south side of town. The park was about as far as you could get from the University of Iowa and still be in city jurisdiction. When I told them that, the wife went quiet, looking down at her hands with an expression I couldn't read. I didn't realize.
Either of you know what he'd be doing out there? The old man grunted a negative. The wife didn't answer. Is Ryerson's Woods significant to Matthew?
He proposed to me there. She lifted her hand, flashing a platinum band with two diamonds hugging a large geometric blue stone.
Pretty. That a sapphire?
She nodded. He made it. He said I should have a ring to match my eyes. Those eyes scanned the top of my desk, darting everywhere, landing on nothing.
I didn't have the first clue how someone could make a sapphire. I'd proposed to Shelley with $1,000 solitaire on sale at Greenberg's at the Coral Ridge Mall. Do you go back to that park a lot?
Not for years. We've both been busy with... She glanced at her father-in-law and quickly away. Research.
And this grant he was supposed to be working on, that was part of his research?
She confirmed, and I had her list as many details as she knew. The project name, sponsor, colleagues, anyone who might have seen Matthew between last night and when his car turned into a bonfire.
Does he gamble? Have any financial problems?
No. We've always been secure financially. She had some money set aside from her father's life insurance and said Matthew inherited some investments from a close family friend.
Does he have any enemies?
They shifted a glance at each other, but neither volunteered any names.
I waited until she was done writing down the grant stuff before ripping the Band-Aid all the way off. What about Kara Johnson?
It hadn't taken more than 2 minutes this morning to find out Matthew Moore, wherever he was dirty.
One quick Google search turned up 10 articles about the disgraced University of Iowa chemistry professor.
The story first broke in August, complete with a video of Moore exiting an undergrad's apartment in the middle of the night. The footage wasn't explicit, but it showed the two of them wrapped around each other, tight enough to suggest the rest. The Press Citizen seethed exploitation outrage, and the university immediately placed Moore on administrative leave, pending the results of an investigation. When I called the university, they would only confirm the investigation was ongoing. At the mention of the student's name, Eve Roth's back straightened and a tremor vibrated through her body. I don't know Kara Johnson.
But your husband did.
I waited her out, cocking an eyebrow until she became uncomfortable enough to elaborate. Matthew said it wasn't an inappropriate relationship, that he was simply offering comfort to a student who was going through a hard time. I noted the disclaimer. Matthew said.
Are they still in contact?
No, not that I know of. But she didn't seem sure about that. I leaned back in my chair, considering Dr. Eve Roth, as Suzeki went to take his second morning pass at the vending machine. After 15 years on the force, and 5 years of dream chasing with Jonah before that, I'd learned there were two truths in every story. I'd gotten good at putting the first kind in the computer, disjointed facts that told you nothing beyond the necessary fields of an incident report. Those truths led to arrests, records, and verdicts. The second kind was harder to know. It hid underneath the surface of things, clotting up motives and memories, the kind of truth that didn't have a timeline or any witnesses to verify it. Like Jonah. It was hard to describe the friendship I had with Jonah, the purpose we'd carved in each other, or the reason I'd left work 6 weeks ago with two working arms, gone out with my increasingly unhinged friend, and returned with a gunshot wound. I'd filled out the disability claim with clipped sentences, all of them accurate, and none of them even touching the truth of that day. I told the truth that would fit on the form. The story of Matthew Moore, at least the one I could enter in his missing person case file, was becoming clearer. A man with a history of not inappropriate relationships with women outside his marriage, told his father and wife he was going to work this morning and went to a remote park instead, where his car got torched in the middle of a downpour. There was a chance, when I first picked up the case, that Matthew Moore might have reported the car stolen, that he hadn't been involved in what happened out at Ryerson's Woods. But I'd had this case for hours now. Past the window for a Tesla owner to storm into the station in a space Karen rage. He'd lied about where he was going, maybe to cheat on his wife again, and something went sideways with the side piece, or maybe the wife had had enough. Underneath the designer briefcase and styled hair, beneath the story of the worried spouse and caring daughter-in-law, would be another truth entirely. A woman with a strong motive. Dr. Roth, when I checked the university directory, it said your research interests include atmospheric and environmental physics.
That's correct.
Seems like you'd know how to burn something up in the middle of a 40-degree downpour. She exhaled, long and steady, and stared at that rock on her hand.
It's a question of thermodynamics, the heat of the fire versus the cold of the water. Generally, the water will either absorb enough heat or suffocate the fire to put it out. But that didn't happen here, at least not before the combustion consumed all available fuel.
Come again?
There must have been an accelerant.
She seemed to be talking more to herself than me. What kind of accelerant?
My inbox notification flashed. The crime scene report on the vehicle had come in. She shook her head and blinked, looking up. That's what I hoped you could tell us?
I flipped my notebook shut, giving them the usual assurances that I'd let them know about any developments. After walking them out, I pulled up the crime scene report. No surprise, the technicians determined it was arson. Someone had filled part of the interior and area surrounding Matthew Moore's car with an unidentified substance, an accelerant, that turned the vehicle into an $80,000 pile of scrap metal at the same park where Eve Roth's cheating husband had proposed to her. It wasn't a truth that fit in the report, not yet, but I was just getting started.
Eve. The Ryerson's Woods parking lot was flooded. Rain pummeled my jacket hood as I stood next to the van. Snowbanks, piled high from the plows, encircled the lot, leaving the water with nowhere to drain. The sewers were blocked with packed snow. The rain was trapped, drowning a world that couldn't absorb it. I don't know what I expected to find here. Police tape? A barricade? Officers scouring the area for some trace of Matthew. But there was nothing. Except for us, the lot was empty. An oblong scorch mark marred the pavement in one spot, and even that was rapidly disappearing beneath the storm. "Don't get out," Earl grunted from the back seat. "I'm serious, I'll be right back." I waded to the mark and scraped the best sample I could. It was black, sooty, and smelled faintly of garlic. There was something familiar about it, but I couldn't place what. Capping the specimen vial, I paced the edges of the rising water, searching for more evidence, anything the police might have missed. My hands shook, not from the cold or the rain, they trembled with absence, the inability to grab on to something and hold fast. What had Matthew been doing here? His grant research focused on trace contaminants in pharmaceuticals.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.